Africa, directors, members, volunteers, you know, the young next generation sang about they will change the world in Hebrew for those who understood. But I have a good example here from this generation already that is changing the world, change the world, influence Israel, and change Israel as well. It's a difficult morning, you know, my attention is elsewhere, following what's going on in Israel. But I'm happy to be here with you to tell you just a bit about where Israel is standing right now in order for all of you to understand how valuable and incredible contribution you made, or you all made, and that you have a part of what's going on in Israel. Even though it's a challenging morning, even though the threats in Israel never cease, actually my message here is that when we celebrate now the 70th year of Israel, we were never better. Actually, the state of Israel was never better in our short history. So sometimes when rockets are keep falling on our heads there, we forget that message. We have to live just for 1 minute. This daily routine in conflict, and just stand aside for 1 minute to acknowledge what we did in only 70 years, which is amazing. Amazing, completely incredible. And you cannot find any other example in the world for achieving so many things in such a short time. Security-wise, for example, even though, again, missiles are falling, fire burning, actually the people of Israel are safer than ever. We have this terrible, cynical statistic that shows how many casualties every year, terrible thing to do, but you have to rely on numbers. And actually 2017, also 2018, were relatively quiet compared to other years since our independence in 48. Yes, we will always have those challenges, and it's always not only in one area, it's always coming in pairs. So today our attention is mostly to the north frontier with Syria, what's going on there, and to the south frontier with Gaza, what's going on there. But again, I want you to move aside a bit from those 300 rockets and everything that is happening today to understand that Israel is safer than before. Protecting itself, even 300 missiles were intercepted by our incredible technologies, Iron Dome. What other country will receive 300 missiles and it will not transmit itself to hundreds of casualties? So, our security is better than ever, but we have to explain for those who don't understand what's going on, for example, in Gaza Strip right now. Sometimes even powerful Israel is being played and it's out of our hands. For example, a few months ago, Hamas managing Gaza find itself completely isolated. Iran is visiting Syria, Turkey is elsewhere, Qatar is fighting in Saudi Arabia and the Gulf countries. Abu Mazen, the president of the Palestinian Authority, is not paying salaries. Nobody is giving any attention to poor Hamas. So what do? They take their people and they storm to the borders. They make clashes. They sacrifice them with the hope that as many casualties will be on their side. What kind of a leadership send its people to the borders to cut the fences and storm into Jordan towards the south of Israel, by the way, they are not coming to have a cup of tea with us? What kind of a leadership send its people there and hope actually that as many people will be killed or injured in order to get back to the center of attention of the world? This is what we're dealing with. I always give examples and it will happen today again, of those young pilots of Israel army that have to come and intercept, or they are finding out that somebody is about to shoot a missile and they are about to eliminate the problem, yet they find that they shoot the missile from schools and kindergartens and clinics. So you are a 20-year-old Israeli pilot and you have 1 second or 2 seconds to decide if you're going to shoot or not, and one death jeopardizing kids on the other side. This is what we have to face. This is what we have to decide. This is what our kids, I have a son and a soldier, this is what our kids need to decide daily. And the world doesn't know it. This is what we face. With one hand, we need to protect our people, but the second hand of Israelis is always look for international, respect international law, respect humanitarian lives, try to balance between these two incredible things. This is what the enemy does, use the fact that we are like that in order to penetrate in, in order to send their people, in order to use whatever attention we can get, and it works. Suddenly Egypt is mediating between Israel and Hamas, suddenly Qatar is paying salaries for the people of Gaza, suddenly and President, the Palestinian President Abu Mazen is interacting with them, suddenly they are back in the news and papers and newspapers in South Africa. So you see, even powerful Israel is sometimes a tool. It's being played, but we have no other option but to protect our people. And we keep doing that while we do our utmost to also consider the population of Gaza in the most humane way. And sometimes worry about their wealth and health and lives more than their leadership. While we do that in the second area of Syria as well, everything is bloody and collapsing, and we are giving attention to that area as well. We don't want it to be a front Iranian location that they will present their forces there instead of thousands of kilometers away, they will be on our borders. We don't want Syria to become a place where missiles are crossing to Lebanon. We don't want them that they, when they shoot each other, it will infiltrate from Golan. So we have interests to keep there as well. So it's not a dull moment in the Middle East. We chose that neighborhood. I don't know, here it's more calm. But I don't want it to shadow on our situation, because we did remarkable things in the last few decades. Leaving security and going to politics, Israel, look at us. We are such a close proximity with the American administration. They moved the embassy to Jerusalem. Suddenly Israel, for the first time, is present in Latin America. In Asia, they need our innovation so much. So we are there much than before. Chinese deputy president was in Israel. India, one of the closest countries to Israel lately. Vietnam, Korea, all those places are engaging with Israel daily, because we have something the world wants. I always give an example that a decade ago, if you had looked at the big 10 companies of the world, it will be fuel companies and banks. And if you are a fuel company or bank and you look for business in the Middle East, Israel is the last place you want to be. Because they have petrol, because they have a bigger market, and you need investment, so you don't go to Israel. 10 years passed quickly. Look at the biggest 10 companies today. High-tech, everything. Facebook, Google, Intel, Amazon. Where is the first place they want to make business in the Middle East now? It's Israel. The world changed, and Israel is in front of the changes now. So the world understands it. Look at my prime minister going to Oman. Look at ministers going to the Emirates. Openly, we don't buy anything anymore. We talk to the Saudis. Because the moderate Arab world understands that Israel is not part of the problem anymore. Israel is part of their solutions. Extremism needs to be taken out of the Middle East. It's not Israel. They need innovation, they need us to help with water knowledge, fight in the desert. And we can contribute so much of that. I understand as well. Look at the world. Africa. Our situation with Africa. So many visits from African countries to Israel that my African division of the ministry cannot handle it. There are too many. President, Prime Minister, Parliament. They are opening embassies in Israel, like Tanzania. Israel is opening another embassy in Rwanda. Two more trade offices will be opened in Kenya and Ghana. By the way, I recommend you all to go and see our innovation here in Cape Town at Africa Com. It starts today. I'm going to go from here to open the Israeli pavilion with marvelous 10 Israeli companies there. BRICS. South Africa is so proud of participating in this prestigious club. Yet look at our relations with the rest of the countries of BRICS. India, Russia, China, and now Brazil, the fourth members of the five. Because they understand, those countries, that you can have double relationship with each other. You can argue on politics. You can see, you can have a dispute and not see eye to eye when it comes to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But in the meantime, it doesn't mean you change on everything and you stop everything. In the meantime, you can improve people's to people life and have Israeli innovation and knowledge in their countries. So this is what we do with the rest of the four members of BRICS. So I hope, and I'm optimistic, that it will happen with the fifth member of BRICS as well, which is South Africa. This is what we try to do. So, security-wise, even though it's a tough day, relatively quiet in Israel. Politically, never been better. With the rest of the world opening, Prime Minister is traveling in the back, I cannot even follow his traveling anymore. Once it's Trump, then it's Deputy President Pence, then it's the Chinese is going to Putin, he meets Macron from France. And that is, brings me to the third element, which is my favorite, our economy. Look at our economy. I can hardly explain it even as an Israeli ambassador to the people. Just a few weeks ago, we were upgraded by the credit rating agencies to a double A group. Now, a double A group is only below the triple A group, which is the best 20 economies in the world, those two groups. When South Africa is dealing so much with becoming, with downgrading to be junk status, Israel is only getting up to the 20th economy in the world. Our economy, by the way, is bigger than South Africa, even though we are 1/8 of the people of South Africa, 1/7. The same economy, we produce the same. Our unemployment, first in 70 years, being down than 4%. Here, the numbers are between 27 to 38, even more informal. 4% in Israel. For 14 years in a row, Israel has a growth. Every year we grow. Even when a decade ago it was a crisis, global crisis, Israel continued to grow. I always love to give an example about NASDAQ. NASDAQ is the second largest stock exchange in New York. It's the technological one. It's the second biggest in the world. 770 Israeli companies are being traded there. We are only after the United States, of course, it's their home, and China. We have more Israeli companies there than the Europe together, UK, Germany, France. China and the United States, by the way, are 500 times bigger than Israel. And we do the same thing. So, and I always remind my audience that we do that when we invest, let's generalize and say 50% of our energy into security. We buy planes, we buy tanks, we train the army. Imagine they will come and we put 100% of our effort into that, into our economy and health and education and improving the world in Tikkun Olam. Imagine 100% of the Israeli energy going only for good cause. So, and our companies are being sold every week now in billions of dollars. Mobileye was sold to Intel in March. I think it was 800 billion rand. Now the government